It's good to see everybody. It's good to see some of you folks back with us. I know we've had some different types of things have been going around our community, not just COVID lately, and some folks haven't done very well with it. But anyway, it's good to see everybody back. And also, we've had a couple families here that have lost loved ones recently, and we want to keep them in our prayers. I did get a chance. Well, by the way, it's good to see Flea back. He survived. He got tired of me calling him, probably. Got to the point where it's hello, and then it was like yesterday, how you doing, buddy? I mean, you know, when he answered the phone. So it's good to see him back with us. And also, you know, it's good to see Amy back with us. She's been gone for a few weeks, and good to see her here. And also, I won't call her DJ, but anyway, Debbie Jenkins, she's back there. Good to see her back from her travels. Anyway, it's good to see everybody's smiling faces, and it's just great to have you here today. You know, I like to start my messages with something funny. It seems that this little boy and little girl in the neighborhood, they were going to play together. The mothers got together for a play date, and they were going to get together, and the little girl decided she wanted to play wedding. She wanted to play wedding. You know how little girls are. And so she basically was trying to help the little boy know how to play wedding. So she said, this is how it goes. These are the vows. The vows are important in a wedding, and this is how it goes. You have the right to remain silent. If you give up the right to remain silent, anything you say can and will be used against you. You may now kiss the bride. Anyway, you have your Bibles with you today. I'd like you to turn to Mark, the very first chapter of Mark, the Gospel of Mark, beginning with verse 40. Now a leper came to him, imploring him, kneeling down to him, and saying to him, if you're willing, you can make me clean. Then Jesus, moved with compassion, stretched out his hand and touched him, and said to him, I am willing, be cleansed. As soon as he had spoken, immediately the leprosy left him, and he was cleansed. And he strictly warned the man and sent him away at once, saying, see that you say nothing to anyone, but go your way, show yourself to the priest, and offer for the cleansing those things which Moses commanded in a testimony to them. However, he went out, began to proclaim it freely, and spread the matter, so that Jesus could no longer openly enter the city, but was outside in deserted places, and they came to him from every direction. Let's bow his word of prayer. Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we're so thankful, Father, for the opportunity we have today to come here to worship you. My prayer today, Father, is that each of us will truly humble ourselves before your throne, recognizing that this is a place of worship, a place to come and to turn our hearts and minds toward you and to give you thanks. You're an amazing God. Thank you, Father, for your amazing grace, for sending Jesus to die for our sins. We pray just now as we study from your word, we ask that you will be with us and guide us. Let your Holy Spirit help us in such a way that we truly glean from your word, have a better understanding of your word, and then we can live stronger lives for you and your service. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, I play videos at the end of my messages, and last week I played one, and it was at the end of a song called Take Heart, and it was a new video. We've had the song Take Heart at the end of messages before, but it was a brand new video. At the very end, I don't know if I've ever had a video that impacted me as I was doing my research as much as that video did. At the very end of that video last week, it showed Jesus, an animated Jesus, walking down a road, and a man with leprosy was behind a rock hiding. And as Jesus approached, he stepped out from behind the rock, and Jesus touched him. Touched his arm. And then it showed a close-up of the man's face, the man with leprosy, his face. and tears filled his eyes, and he began to weep. And I thought to myself, I wonder how long it had been since somebody had touched him, because lepers were not allowed to be touched. And so I decided right then, I'm going to preach a sermon on that. Well, here you go, guys. This is it. Why do we touch a leper? They were untouchable, declared unclean, outcasts, and they were supposed to be around anybody. But Jesus touched the man. Why would he do something like that? And what can you and I learn from what Jesus did that day on that road when he touched that man, that leper? If you're an average-sized adult, your skin covers about 21 square feet of your body. And it will weigh about 9 pounds. And it contains about 11 miles of blood vessels. Your skin holds the body together and protects you from various bacteria and viruses. In hot weather, your skin will release as much as 3 gallons of sweat a day. Most people think the only reason we have fingerprints is so the law can figure out where we are and what we've done if we've done something wrong. But God designed them in such a way that you'd have the ability to grip items in your hands without letting them slip through. I don't know, it didn't work too good in some of my basketball players. Maybe they should have bigger fingerprints. But anyway, amen, Ben? And Ben said, yeah, amen. You know, we should definitely clean up after ourselves. Our mothers were right. Your skin sheds 50,000 cells every minute. Globally, dead skin accounts for about 1 billion tons of dust in the atmosphere. Your skin is a very special creation by God, and one of the primary functions of your skin is to help you to feel and to feel the world around you. There are at least 5 different receptors in the skin that help us respond to pain and to touch. The blind person actually literally sees the world through touch and through sound. Back in the 1940s, someone decided to conduct a study of 26 people, 26 children in an orphanage. The babies were more or less cut off from human contact in their cribs. By the time the babies were 1 year old, the isolated babies were less curious, less playful, and more subject to infections. When they were 2 or 3 of the 26 children in the group, only 2 at age 3 could walk and manage even a few words. Doug, a firefighter, he talks about being at a scene of a house fire. And he says the story is almost always the same. You get to the house fire and it's total devastation. The people of the home are in total shock, serious shock. And what he discovered was if he sat quietly with them and quietly touched their shoulder or their hand as he spoke to them, the victim would suddenly calm down and be comforted by a simple touch. The ability to be touched can make all the difference in our lives. The truth makes the story we've read all the more powerful. Leprosy is a horrible disease. If untreated, leprosy, and thank goodness we have a cure for it today, leprosy, a victim of leprosy has an average lifespan of about 10 years. It usually starts with a feeling of fatigue and pain in the joints. Now, if I stop there, you all would say, oh my God, I got leprosy. But the next part of the symptoms are scaly spots develop on the skin, and the body becomes covered with lumps that are filled with pus. The face changes its shape so that the sufferer would suddenly become like a lion looks in the face. Growths develop on the vocal cords, so the leper's voice becomes raspy. The body begins to decompose, and the leper has a terrible stench Nobody wants to touch the leper. The disease attacks the nervous system, so the leper might step on a stone or a thorn, and then, not even knowing it, the foot becomes infected. And as it becomes infected, the foot may just fall off. Infection sets in without them even knowing it. He might try to wash his face with scalding water and actually blind himself because he has no sense of anything, any pain. He put his hands in scalding water and not even know it. He could reach into a fire and pick up a potato that fell in the fire and actually burn himself and not even know it. So he had no sense of feeling pain. God imposed quarantines on lepers. They were unclean. They were forbidden to actually fellowship with people or be around other people or even be around their loved ones. They were allowed to come and worship. They were completely isolated from society. And when they walked down the street, they had to shout out when they saw someone approaching, unclean, unclean, which told the people coming toward them to avoid them because they had leprosy. They were not to be touched, and they were not to touch. To touch a leper was to expose yourself to the disease. But among his very first healings Jesus performed, it was a leper. Why? Well, because this man was an outcast. He was shunned by society and cut off from God. He was the very type of person that Jesus had come to heal. The people Jesus healed was his business card, his calling card. The most prominent healing Jesus could possibly have was a leper. Because everybody in that society thought how horrible it would be to have leprosy, to be cut off, to be shunned by everybody, to be isolated, to be in a colony with people that you didn't even know and you couldn't even associate with anybody. You couldn't be around your friends or your loved ones anymore because you had leprosy. And they recognized the hardship and the horror of having leprosy back in those days. And so when Jesus chose as one of his very first healings the healing of a leper, it impacted everybody. Basically, it told the folks, hey, there's hope. You know, we live in a society today where a lot of folks think there is no hope. Life is tough. Look what we're going through. Gee, someone gets COVID. They got to be isolated. Does this leprosy story sound familiar? They got to be isolated away from everybody. They got to be quarantined. Yeah. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? But what Jesus is seeing here, he gave folks hope in those days because he chose to heal the leper. And the person, thing is about it, back in those days, when someone contracted leprosy, you could have been the most important person in the community, supposedly, by society standards. But if you contracted leprosy, they don't even remember what you did. They just remember the fact that, guess what? He's got leprosy or she's got leprosy. I can't be around them. And so you lost everything that you'd worked hard for your whole life. And you were labeled as an outcast and you were shunned. But the real story today is not the fact that Jesus healed him. The real story to me, and the reason I got tears in my eyes while I was doing my research for last week's sermon, and I found that video, the real story is that Jesus touched him. Jesus touched the man. Jesus touched many people when he healed them. He touched Simon Peter's mother-in-law. He touched her hand when he healed her. He actually touched the eyes of the blind man when he healed him. He actually touched the hand of the little girl when he raised her from the dead. He put his fingers in the ears of the man who could not hear to give him back his hearing. Jesus had touched a lot of people when he healed them, but there's a lot of people that he didn't touch. If we look in Luke, the 17th chapter, in Luke, the 17th chapter, beginning with verse 12, it says this. Then as he entered a certain village, there met him 10 men who were lepers, who stood afar off. And that's what they did. They didn't come close to Jesus. And they lifted their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. So when he saw them, he said to them, go show yourself to the priests. And so it was, it's as they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, returned and with a loud voice glorified God, fell down on his face at his feet, giving him thanks, and he was a Samaritan. So Jesus answered and said, were there not 10 cleansed, but where are the other 9? Were there not any found who returned to give glory to God except for this foreigner? And he said to him, arise, go your way, your faith has made you well. He didn't touch these lepers. He's walking down the road one day, and these 10 lepers come toward him, and they're far off, and they holler, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on us. And Jesus said, I will. Go show yourself to the priests. Now, the lesson we need to learn here, folks, is this. They had to call out what they really wanted God to do. They had to make it specific. So many times people pray. When they pray, they don't pray in specifics. You know, are you a wandering generality when you pray? Or are you a meaningful specific? You know, Lord, you know what I need, but he still wants to hear it from you. He wants you to tell him specifically what you want. Those lepers, they said, have mercy on us. They wanted mercy. He said, I will. Go show yourselves to the priests. And he commanded them. Once they proclaimed what they wanted, God, Jesus, said, go show yourself to the priest, which is what lepers were supposed to do if they were going to be cleansed. And the Bible says, as they were on their way, they were cleansed. Wow. What's that tell you to me? It tells you to me that when I pray for something, I shouldn't just sit back and wait. I should get up off my knees and go back about my business and keep moving forward. I don't just sit there and wait for God to do something. God tells us to stay in the game. That's the lesson he tries to teach us. Too many times people say, well, I really don't feel like being in the game. I don't want to play. The coach is saying, get in the game. And you're saying, I'm going to sit on the bench a while. I don't feel like being in the game. God doesn't want us to do that. God wants us to be in the game at all times. And so in this specific situation here, with this one leper, he came from behind a rock, as was in the video. And as he came from behind the rock, Jesus saw him, recognized him as a leper, and he touched him. But why did he touch this man? Why would Jesus touch this man? It's in the Bible. In the passage I read to start with today, first chapter of Mark, the 41st verse, it says this, then Jesus, moved with compassion, stretched out his hand and touched him and said to him, I am willing, be cleansed. Compassion. He heard for this man. He knew what this man was going through. A couple years ago in 2019, I don't even know if I've even shared this with Jane. We had a lady here at our church that I loved and you all loved, and she's a wonderful lady, and her husband had attended with her. They sat back there beside Olin and Janie. And Joel McDonald passed away in February, and later on that year, after our retreat at Landman's, she started with a cough. And I was in contact because she had missed church. And I was talking with her, and she said, well, I'm okay. March wasn't okay. And I waited about a week, and I said, you need to get to the doctor. I'm okay. Called her the next day. Still hadn't been to the doctor yet. Here's the deal. Preachers don't normally do this, Marge. You need to call Melanie, your daughter, and you need to have her come get you and take you to the doctor. Or take you to an emergency room, but you need to go. And if you don't, by the end of the week, the preacher's going to call the life squad and have them come pick you up and take you there, because you're not going to get better the way things are going. Because I've had pneumonia. Now I've had it twice. At that time, I'd had it once. Well, Melanie came. She got a hold of Melanie. Melanie came, and she took her to the hospital. They transferred to Ohio State. And so they admitted her to a high state. And those of you who knew Marge, she's just a sweetheart. And I went up to visit with her. And when I got there, this has never happened to me as a minister. They had me put on these things on my feet, like I'm a surgeon. And they had me put on these things over my pants. And I had to wear like a gown over my top. I had to wear like a bathing cap on my head. I had to put a mask on. And I had to wash my hands and put on rubber gloves before I even went in the room. Never had that happen before. I don't think I told Jade about that because I didn't want her to be alarmed, because if they're making me do that, what did she have, right? But I went in there that night and we talked for about 20 minutes. And we talked about the importance of being a Christian. And because you're a Christian, guess what happens? When you face adversities and you wonder what's going to happen, the assurance is this. Like I told my own children before I went in for open heart surgery, it's okay. I'm either going to wake up here or I'm going to wake up there. Either way, it's going to be fine. I'm not worried at all. And my daughter kept telling Jane, how can he be so calm? It's called faith. Well, Marge and I talked that night about faith and about the importance of being a Christian and why we have a place to go. And then I said, I want to pray with you before I go. She put her hand up like she wanted me to hold her hand when I prayed. And I took it. I had a rubber glove on. Wasn't the same. I took it. And we prayed together. And when I got done praying, I looked at her and she had tears on her cheeks because we connected in our faith. And I think sometimes just the touch of someone else, even through a rubber glove, has an impact on people. And that's why this leper was so impacted when Jesus touched him that day. We all know that Marge went to heaven. She never left that hospital. She went to heaven. But I had a chance to talk to her about heaven before she left. It's a great time. I'll never forget it the rest of my life. You see, touching people was one of the best ways Jesus had. And he could tell people that he loved them, that he cared for them, that he had pity on what they were suffering with. It is said that Eastern shepherds, as he brings his sheep back into the fold at night, he stands there at the gate. And as the sheep come by and start to go back into the fold, he counts them, each one. We've all heard the story about the 99, right? Well, the sheep come into the fold. He touches them on the head as they come in the gate. Every one of them, he touches them on the head. And then he talks to them as they're going in. And he does the same thing when they're out in the fields during the day. He'll touch them on the head, and then he'll talk to them. What's that for? Well, because his touch is the way his sheep know who he is. And because they know who he is, they'll know his voice and how he speaks to them. Julie read a scripture last week when she was up here, 2 weeks ago. Anyway, it was from Psalm 100. It says, we are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Why did he touch the leper? He cares for us in a way no one else can. Did you hear that? You think you're going through adversities and problems. You think you're going through difficulties. You think you can't survive. You think, oh my, no one's going through what I'm going through. You don't know my problems, preacher. I want to tell you something. God knows your problems better than you do. And he knows there's not one problem that you can possibly have that he can't handle. There's not one. He's with you every step of the way. Every step that you take, he promised to be with you no matter what. And there's not one problem. So when he touched that leper thought it was hopeless. My life is over. There's nothing I can do. And Jesus touched him and gave him hope. He gave him hope again. He said, because God Almighty is not concerned about something that I'm going through so much that he feels like he can't handle it. Because there's nothing that I'm going through that God cannot handle. That's what he was telling us. No matter what pain we're going through, what adversity we're going through, God's with us and will get us through it. He loves us and cares for us. And he touches us. Jesus touched him because nobody else in the world would. It was that touch that God showed people how much he cared for them. When I was in Bible college, I went to school with a guy, I know his name was Doug Nichols. And in my research this week for this sermon, I came across a story I want to read with you today about a man named Doug Nichols. He talks about, he was a missionary in the 1960s in India. Could very possibly be the same guy. But his trip was sidelined when he developed tuberculosis. He was forced to stay in a sanitarium for several months. He said he didn't speak the language yet, but he tried to give out Christian literature written in the language of the patients, the doctors, and the nurses. Everyone politely refused. He sensed that they weren't too happy about a rich American. To them, all Americans are rich. Being in a free, government-run sanitarium, they didn't realize Doug was broke. The first few nights, he woke up around 2 a.m. coughing. He wrote, "One morning during my coughing spell, I noticed one of the older and sicker patients across the aisle was trying to get out of bed. He would sit up on the edge of the bed, try to stand, but in weakness, he'd fall back into bed. I didn't understand what he was trying to do. He finally fell back into bed exhausted. I heard him crying softly. The next morning, I realized what the man had been trying to do. He'd been trying to get up and walk to the bathroom. The stench in our ward was awful. Other patients yelled insults at the man. Angry nurses moved him roughly from side to side as they cleaned up the mess. One nurse even slapped him. The old man curled up in a ball and he wept. The next night, I woke again, coughing. I noticed a man across the aisle sit up and try to stand like the night before. He fell back whimpering. I don't like bad smells, and I didn't want to become involved, but I got out of bed and went over to him. When I touched his shoulder, his eyes opened wide with fear. I smiled, put my arms under him, picked him up. He was very light due to old age and advanced tuberculosis. I carried him to the washroom, which was just a filthy small room with a hole in the floor. I stood behind him with my arms under his armpits as he took care of himself. After he finished, I picked him up and carried him back to his bed. As I laid him down, he kissed me on the cheek, smiled, and said something I couldn't understand. The next morning, another patient woke me up, handing me a steaming cup of tea. He motioned with his hands that he wanted a tract. As the sun arose, other patients approached and indicated they also wanted the booklets. Throughout the day, nurses and interns and doctors asked for the literature. What made the difference? Why did so many respond that they had rejected the literature just days before? The difference was he had touched a man others avoided, and he changed the lives of dozens. Because of it. When I was in college, I was blessed to be in a quartet, and I sang the lead, and I'll never forget these kids. Bobby Petrie sang tenor, and Dave Fagan sang baritone, and John Bowling sang bass. And I was on the basketball team, so I wasn't able to practice that much. But in the fall of the year before basketball season, and in the spring of the year after basketball season, we would sometimes go to churches and we would sing. And as we would sing, thank goodness the other three were really good, quite frankly. But we sang. And one of the songs was fairly new back then. It's about 6 or 7 years old at that time. And we sang it. We didn't sing it like you're going to see today, but I'm going to play a video for you right now. And at the end of this, they're going to continue to sing, and if you know the words, when he starts to lead it in corporate, if you want to join in and sing with the video at the end, you can.
Moore and I wrote this back in 1990. 63. Right when your mom and daddy were just courted, right?
Just courted.
Sing that song again the way I will, because I tell you, it will not be the same because of the impact of the lessons that I've learned. I mean, I knew Jesus touched the leper. I knew that. But doing the research on the fact of what that meant. And because of that, he's touched millions of lives since then. He's touched my life. He's touched your life. And, you know, when we think about the leper and how he touched him and he made him whole, not just from the outside, but from the inside, because he had a grateful heart. That's something that's what he's done for us. We just need to give praise to God, amen? God's a great God, isn't he? Boy, I tell you, isn't it just amazing that Almighty God is so interested in little old you? Seriously. You have no idea how much he loves you and how much he cares for you. And when you think you're all by yourself and you're going through adversities and problems, nothing could be further from the truth. He's right there with you. It's like the story about the guy who was talking to Jesus and they were going back over his life. It's called Footprints in the Sand. We've all seen that, right? And how, you know, they're watching and he's explaining to him how they're walking together. They see two sets of footprints in the sand. And all of a sudden, the man looks at Jesus and he says, well, why did you leave me here in this one part right here? And there's only one set of footprints. And Jesus said, my child, that's when I carried you, because you needed me to. Jesus loves us. Amen? Let's bow our heads. Father in heaven, it's been great to be here today and to study your word. We ask that each of us will take this lesson, apply it to our hearts, recognizing, Father, that you're constantly involved in our lives. Thank you for the direction that you give us. You're amazing, Father. You are a faithful friend. Even when sometimes we're not so faithful, you are a faithful friend. Thank you, Father. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.